Now I take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Nandita Sujeer for today's workshop. Dr. Nandita Sujeer did her undergraduate from Manipal College of Dental Sciences, Mangalore in the year 2009 and proceeded to complete her master's in oral medicine and radiology from Manipal College of Dental Sciences, Manipal. She is a Mahe Famer Fellow, batch of 2017. For her fellowship, she has worked on dental practice management education for undergraduates, which has been institutionalized and also has won best paper awards in international as well as national conferences. She is also an active member of IDA Dakshina Kannada branch and serves as the editor since past 2 years and is also a member of the Network Towards Unity of Health. She has several national and international publications too to her credit. Ma'am, we welcome you for today's workshop. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. So thank you for that warm introduction. I would like to start by saying congratulations to Yenapoya Dental College on the launch of the Yenapoya Dental Education Unit. A big congratulations to the Dean and Dr. Imran Pasha for this initiative, which is much needed. And I bring greetings from Manipal College of Dental Sciences, Mangalore. And I must start the presentation with some gratitude and acknowledgements first. First of all, to my institute for supporting me in all my endeavors to pursue the fellowship in Mahe Famer Institute. And that is where I have learned about interprofessional education practice and care and everything to do about it. And you have seen the faculty, address you so far, and they are the best of the best. And it's a real honor right now for me to share the stage with them. So a big thank you to the institute as well. So moving on, my topic is interprofessional education in dentistry. Now, you have heard a lot about interprofessional education, practice and care over the last, yesterday and today. From the best experts. So my aim or the content what I have prepared for today is mainly examples in interprofessional education, which are more to do with dentistry, but all can learn from how to go about it, because after all it's a healthcare problem. The main thing for me is for dentists in the group, I know we have a mixed group, you will know probably about the scope of IP in dentistry, and you'll have role clarification about, all the other health professionals in their contribution to promoting oral health and providing good care. For the other health professionals in the team, you will know about your own role in contribution to health promotion. And hopefully you will have more awareness about a dentist in a healthcare team. And of course, a small bit I have put on, value of a dentist in healthcare force expansion. So the problem in dental or any healthcare is common, where we face a lot of disease burden and we have shortage of healthcare professionals to manage it. And economically managed. So, and to make it more context specific, I have included examples from the Indian context. And for that, I didn't have to look very further because there were a lot of very good projects in the Mahe Famer Institute. And I must thank all the fellows again through their projects. Also, we have learned a lot. The fellows to, contributing their projects for this presentation or giving me the details for that. So, thank you to the fellows. So let's begin. So you have all, heard about interprofessional collaborative practice. So what it basically is that multiple healthcare, professionals come together as a team and work towards promoting patient and community health. Now the patient is always at the center, and you will have a wide range of professionals, and you would have seen many examples so far who can contribute to promoting patient health. Now, this list is not by all means very extensive, but these are the professionals that I've seen in the institute work together to solve and come up with great ideas to promote healthcare or, provide interprofessional collaborative care. So, one of the examples from the institute for interprofessional care is we have the next speaker for today, Dr. Ram Prasad. He's also a fellow. So his project was to develop a mobile application for better outcomes in oral health and tobacco cessation and to follow up the patient. So using technology to promote health. And his team members were dentists, Department of Information Technology engineers, you know, software engineers, and community dentists and practitioners. So, you know, this really has a lot of impact when, you know, it can be efficient. Another great example for interprofessional practice is one of Dr. Bhagyalakshmi. I think she's, I've seen her as a participant yesterday. I think she's here also. So she's a reader in JSS Dental College. And her problem or the health problem that she, you know, applied into professional practice was for nasal obstruction. Now, you know, in I've just explained a little more here just to understand the problem. As, you know, to solve nasal obstruction, ENT generally, you know, prescribes medications and it involves surgery. But an orthodontic can, you know, expand the maxilla, you know, with relatively non-invasive procedures, and the outcomes are excellent. And because of her efforts, now we she has established a Breathe Healthy clinic in her institute. And if you see this picture, it is an ideal, you know, setup for interprofessional practice, where they are all professionals surrounding the patient and working together as a team to deliver the best care for the patient. Another example which I would like to give is a community-based project where, you know, preventive efforts are taken here by Dr. Vidya. She's HOD in Department of Public Health Dentistry in AG Institute. And her is a very community-based where she has included Anganwadi workers, the local, you know, health departments in promoting oral health. Through, you know, fluoride application and things like that. So this has, you know, improved oral health outcomes mainly in social media.
Ma'am, you can go ahead.
Yeah, okay, sorry. So to improve oral health outcomes in socioeconomically marginalized population with really less, it's a very cost-effective treatment. So these are some of the examples. Now, why did I start off with examples of interprofessional care and interprofessional practice? Because everything that, you know, the ultimate outcome for interprofessional care or practice begins with interprofessional education. That is the whole purpose. Interprofessional education is there. So, you know, it begins with local healthcare needs and then how best to get the fragmented systems together. That is the role of interprofessional education, so that ultimately there is collaborative practice and improved health outcomes. This is a diagram which I've taken, I think, from the WHO framework, which has been referenced a lot in this workshop. So it's a very great document. I think all have to go through. So coming to the oral context, now the same model can be applied to improve outcomes in oral health as well. So the, everything which is related to general health, this model shows, you know, its applicability to oral health. So that is this definition is very important. So interprofessional education, and I think that, you know, the diagram also has been extensively used in this program, but it is very important here to, you know, refresh this again. So occasions when members or students of two or more professionals learn with, from, about each other to improve collaboration and the quality of care and services. So it is collaborative learning, and that is the keyword. So ultimately, before we proceed, we must remember that interprofessional education should promote collaborative patient-centered care. And everything we design in the education module should contribute to it. We should assess patient-centered care and its needs and the outcomes associated with it. So that becomes the key here. So what is the rationale for interprofessional education in dentistry? Now, the West has extensively studied their oral health needs and have recognized, the treatment burden that is there. So this article by Coleman says that there is emphasis towards preventive programs now. There's increased aging population, so the burden of disease is also more. And the complexities of the medical situations, the disease is also increasing. And dentists are a part of the healthcare network. So we must include, of course, the dentist in the interprofessional team. Now, coming to the national context in India, the government of India and collaborative program where they did formulate, did look at the disease burden and ways to improve manpower to promote oral health or to tackle oral health. So this document states that the disease prevalence is very high. You can see that almost 50% of the children, 30% of adults are having dental caries. Almost 50 to 100% of the people are having periodontal diseases. Oral cancer, you know the incidences. Dentists know this number quite well. So it's very high. The geriatric problems are high. So there is a increased disease burden here. And they surveyed dental teachers, public health dentists, private practitioners, and graduates, and found that the key problem to tackling this issue is lack of awareness. Lack of awareness could be among other healthcare professionals, it could be among patients, it could be in the community as well. The burden of disease is high. The manpower is inadequate. The government policies are, not up to the mark as of now. So, but the government has definitely taken initiatives and we have a website which gives comprehensive, knowledge about oral health and various situations, and this is a very welcomed initiative by the dentists and thanks to the government for that. So this is a great resource for all health professionals to look at and to see how they can contribute to oral health. So coming on to some of the examples in interprofessional education that were there at the institute. So this was by Dr. Supriya Nambiar. She's the head of the department in orthodontics in my college. And she looked at enhancing competencies among health professionals to improve primary prevention in oral health. And she included students of medical, dental, nursing, and allied and social work students. And I was a part of this project where we went into these dental colleges. And the material that we used was heavily based on the training manual which is published by the government of India. So we already have the resources. It's about implementing it in the best way possible. So the next phase would have been to get the students together and to interact and to come up with good solutions so that they can work together in the team. But because of COVID, certain things got delayed in this project, but it is still, we are on track considering COVID here. Another great example is from a senior fellow, Dr. Kanishk, who is right now in Jeddah, where they looked at geriatric dental model, where the dental and medical students interacted and learned from each other how best to promote oral health in geriatric population, keeping in mind their complex systemic illnesses. So this was the project started in second year and the students were followed up in the third year as well. So a very interactive model was proposed and delivered by Dr. Kanish. And I think Dr. Mukhya Pran Prabhu and Dr. Siraj were also a part of it from KMC Manipal and MMC. So these are the kind of education modules that were there in the institute. Now the question comes, whom to involve? So most of these you have seen, they are mainly undergraduate projects, but IPE can be introduced in post-graduation as well. It can be afterwards in terms of continuing interprofessional education. So when do we decide whom to include? This was one of the questions that was there yesterday also. In terms of dentistry, there is a wide range of domains. Now we need to look at who needs to be competent for what purpose. Now, if it is a primary oral health promotion, then I think all the undergraduate students would be involved. But if it is mainly, if you're looking at promoting oral health in a pediatric population, then maybe you need to include a postgraduate from the pediatrics department as well. So it depends on what kind of module you're looking at or what health problem, specific health problem you're tackling. So the other, domains where IPE has or IPP has been executed in dentistry is management of acute and chronic pain. Now this can be chronic pain management is very, challenging, and especially orofacial pain. So dentist along with a psychologist, if it's orofacial pain, you'll have an orthopedic surgeon, you will might have a physiotherapist, you will have social workers in the team, you will have a pharmacist there. So it's really, but if it is for pain management, here I would recommend a postgraduate from oral medicine or oral surgery department, to be included in the team. Of course, the undergraduate should have the competency to, recognize and do the proper referral as well. So it depends on to what extent you want to teach or the level of competency that needs to be achieved in that IP team where you include the team members. So the other domains include oral health and systemic diseases, forensics, geriatric, special care population. So, really diverse oral health problems are there where, you require the IP team. So this is one of the examples for IPE in, continued interprofessional education. This is a national interprofessional initiative of oral health program in the US, and they have a fantastic website with great resources where the health professionals already practicing can come together and learn. So they have an online teaching curriculum. They also have resources if you want to teach about oral health. And they have come up with a delivery framework, which is ask, look, decide, act, and document, which the entire healthcare team will follow in practice. So this is another great resource. It's a free website which we can look into while we implement our own projects. So right now I've given you a lot of examples in terms of IPE for undergraduates, a little scope for postgraduates and the professionals for continuing interdental interprofessional education. So what, how do you plan an IPE? First, you need to be, clear with your learning objectives and the outcomes, and that needs to finally match what the patient requires or the patient-centered care. So the first thing would be to identify learning objectives. The next would be to identify your IP team. So who are the students or the professionals that you want to get together to teach this module? Then, of course, is the IP facilitators. Who will, implement or facilitate this program. You need to think about which best teaching learning methods or IPE activities are required to fulfill these learning objectives. You need to have a clear assessment plan, which will help you assess if the learning objectives are met or not. Then overall, you need program evaluation. Has the entire module, delivered what it was supposed to? Right, so the process needs to be evaluated. So some of the learning of activities in literature that have been implemented for IPE in dentistry are problem-based learning, case-based learning. I think we had an extensive session on case-based learning yesterday. There is team-based learning, there is simulation, there is peer mentoring, there is journal clubs that have been formulated, and there is standardized patient encounters to simulate the real life situation. So the learning activities, the literature largely indicates the best, choose the best method which can replicate the final situation where the student will be eventually a professional and will, be involved in patient-centered care. So simulate as far as possible the real life scenarios. The assessment methods that are incorporated are written computer testing, OSCEs are there, simulations have been evaluated, There is work-based, assessment like direct observation in clinical settings and review of the clinical documents. Are the students practicing what they learned? And portfolios. Now, a lot of these terms, if you need to be a little well-versed with medical education as well. So a lot of principles of medical education need to be kind of modified for interprofessional education. And finally, evaluation. Evaluation involves feedback from all stakeholders. That includes your student, IP facilitators, the administrators. Was the program cost effective? Was the program, ultimately did the program lead to better patient health outcomes? That is the main important point. You can have reflections for evaluation. So really there is a large scope and methodology in terms of teaching learning methods, the assessment and program evaluation. I need some help here with the chat box. I have just given a small scenario. So I would love inputs from the participants for this. So, if you want to create a module for prevention of dental caries among children visiting your Yenapoya hospital, okay? So can you suggest the learning objectives for this program? So can you just type your inputs in the chat box, or you can unmute and speak? I'm not able to see the chat box, so if
yes, ma'am, we will coordinate, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Imran. So it may not be very extensive, just what do you think should be the learning objectives for prevention of dental caries?
There's a first input in the chat box. It's health education by allied persons.
Sorry, I'm not able to hear. So for a moment, I'll just stop sharing.
Ma'am, there's a first input in the chat box. It says health education by allied persons. Then yeah. There is awareness of family.
Awareness of family, okay. So the health, the team of professionals should be able to communicate to the family for, and motivate them to take on preventive measures like maintaining oral hygiene for their children and participating in preventive measures. Yes. So the communication there becomes very important. So that can be one outcome. Anything else? Okay, so the team needs to be able to identify high-risk caries patients, risk assessment, exactly. So the team needs to be able to assess the risk if the child is high caries prone. They need to be able to communicate to the patient and the family members and motivate them to maintain the oral hygiene. And they need to be able to follow up the patient for better healthcare outcomes. So, and probably, a fluoride application. It is a very, easy skill to master. So maybe that also can be introduced. So these can be some of the learning objectives. So who will be involved in the IP team, you think? So this I will need help. So who should be involved in the IP team? Who are the members? I have listed out 5, but who do you think needs to be involved in the IPT? Do we have any responses?
Yeah, we have pediatrician,
pediatrician, so medical students that can be pediatricians. It also, you know, obstetric OBG department also can be involved, so that, you know, patients are sensitized a little early and the parents are. Yes, so the medical students.
Nursing. Nursing,
excellent, yes. Well, dentist, of course, right? We can't miss out dentist here. Any other suggestions? Okay, so I have been
public health. There's an input as public health.
Right. So specific, you know, public health, dentist, fine. But this is not a community-based setting that I'm looking for. It is a hospital-based. But yes, public health, dentist, public health, you know, medical side also can get a lot of, you know, patients into the hospitals that's there. I mean, help to coordinate that. There will also be social workers in the hospital that take care of patients, and they are, you know, they look after how best the patient can utilize the healthcare systems as well. And I would personally like to include speech pathology students. Now, this has specifically included because during the project which Dr. Supriya implemented, what we realized was speech pathology students already learn a lot about oral structures. That was very new to me. I did not know that until the project was implemented. So they are, of course, you know, when you think about the subject, it makes sense because orofacial structures are very important for speech. So they do know to identify the teeth and they are well versed with a lot of things. So they are again in best place to, you know, screen for oral health issues here. Okay, so we can include you know, this as the IP team. Who will be the facilitators for this IP program, do you think? Who will be best able to facilitate? Which professions can best facilitate this education program?
There's an input which says a dental yes. Faculty, yeah.
Yes, so a dentist, a dental faculty, and I have also included a psychologist for the communicative aspects. You know, they can give great inputs how to motivate, because awareness among patients and of, you know, family members is, you know, is quite low when it comes to their motivation to improve their oral health is also low. So they need to understand how important oral health is and what are the outcomes for that. So a psychologist also can help to, you know, create the module and facilitate especially the communication aspects. And of course, the entire module should, you know, should be developed keeping in mind the competencies for interprofessional collaborative practice, which you have seen, like role clarification. So each one knows what the other person is supposed to do. They communicate well, they work as a team, and they share the value and ethics. So that is the main basic principle of or competency of interprofessional collaborative practice. So we can design a module which includes all of the competencies as well. This is like a wish list, okay? So it's not that easy to come up with a module, but you know, you can plan for it. So what kind of IP activities can people suggest for this? So I have just left this open. Some suggestions can come. I know there are a lot of medical education specialists in the group, so they can also help.
School camps can be conducted.
Yes. So before that, probably how would you teach, you know, the medical student, the social worker, and the rest of the team to identify the oral structures and probably, you know, help to get them to do a risk assessment for dental caries. How could we do that part? So once you've done that, the school camps and things like that, it's great recreation of the real life, you know, situations where they can actually go ahead and implement what they have learned. But basics, that is, you know, how to teach the risk assessment part. Any kind of suggestions?
Could we use PBL or?
Yes, so PBL. There is also peer mentoring, because a dentist student, if you say it's an intern, they will know a lot more, you know, in terms of oral health and issues compared to the peers in the group among the students. So actually, the dentist student can, you know, help the other students understand the whole process. So peer learning, I think, would be a great initiative for this. And yes, case-based learning, PBLs, you can look at simulations, standardized patients for that. Again, assessments, generally we do, you know, formative, summative assessments can be done. It can be through MCQ tests. It can be through reflective writing. So assessment, again, is broad. And evaluation of the program, as I have, you know, earlier told, any of those methods can also be used. So in this way, like this was, you know, we don't have too much time to sit and deliberate about how to go about this module. But, you know, I thought to just include some examples just to get a sense of how to develop an IPE module. So what are the barriers for, you know, IPE in dentistry? Now, they are same for, you know, they are very similar to IPE in general. So they can be administrative issues. You know, if the administrators are not on board, or you know, they do not have the funds for it sometimes. So whatever the reason, then a program will not, you know, do well in the long run. So support of administration is very important. Faculty issues especially in the Indian context, IPE is very new. So faculty development and faculty development programs are need of the hour. So to facilitate an IPE activity, the faculty should be competent and sensitized. So that is the main issue there. And of course, the faculty should, you know, understand the importance of IPE and only then be motivated to work for it. If they are not convinced that this model is going to work, they are not going to work for it. So there can be faculty issues. Curriculum challenges and concerns, you can see that to develop, you know, a curriculum, I think even Yenko is looking to develop, you know, a shift or revise their dental curriculum. You know how difficult it is. And to design a curriculum, keeping in mind the different IPE students or the team members who have varying levels of knowledge, skills and attitude pertaining to a particular problem can be a big challenge. And practical challenges are definitely there. Not all institutes are attached to, you know, other professional institutes. Like now, Manipal, under the university, there are a lot of other professional colleges, so it's very easy to find IP partners. But say in some other dental college, which is in isolation, only attached to a medical hospital, they may not find all the team members there. So those, some of, you know, scheduling can be a big practical challenge. So there can be a lot of practical issues while implementing education modules as well. From yesterday's presentation for Yenapoya Dental Institute, the enabling factors, what I found that you have an excellent cancer center and you know, the VC is a great oncosurgeon. So you already have a team there which is working. You also have a great community family adoption program. Again, a team there is already in place. Now, it is about, even though there is a team in place, it is about implementing interprofessional education. That means to optimize the teamwork, to optimize communication, and to optimize patient health care, you know, to see that no patient has fallen through the cracks or been left out or lost in terms of referral. You will need to put in a framework of assessment and evaluation. And, you know, you need to evaluate the whole process of how things go about. So you already have the processes in place. Maybe it's just about, you know, getting the right framework in place in terms for interprofessional collaborative practice. So evidence, this is a, you know, evidence in science can be quite challenging to get the right evidence. And what kind of evidence we look at also becomes important. So this is, I thought this was funny where, you know, what kind of evidence are we looking at and what kind of decisions we take based on the evidence that we look at is very important. And in terms of IPE, there's a lot of work to be done. The evidence completely is not there. So if you look at systematic reviews, there was one done in 2000 where they did not find any studies which they could include in the systematic review. Another somewhere around 2003 or 4 where they found about I think 9 or 6 or 9 articles, and now recently one was done by Reeves et al, and they have found 15 articles which they could include in Cochrane review to understand interprofessional education practices. That being said, very few of them involve dentists. So, you know, there's a lot of scope to work on this. And when planning an IP module, that article suggested the following things in terms of research. So first, when you plan a project, it is good to look at better randomization procedures. And they recommend cluster randomized designs as, because of the diversity that is involved in IP. Allocation concealment, needs to be better. It needs to be larger sample size. Appropriate control should be selected, and they recommend at least one common outcome for measurement of teamwork should be included in the module, so that, you know, when systematic reviews are done, there is one common measurement that the others can be compared with. And the outcomes need to be, need to reflect how the patient care or how the patient health has improved, and not just how the process has happened. So that is very important. So to just summarize and reflect back on, the talk, IPE is an interactive and collaborative learning, and collaboration is key here. The ultimate goal of IPE is improving patient care. So that should be remembered. The learning outcome should reflect collaborative learning. Prior to the session, it is important to identify the learner's knowledge and learning needs so that you can best apply or best formulate an education module. Build on previous knowledge, build on the strengths that are already there in the system. Consider adult learning principles, reflective learning principles, and, you know, yesterday Dr. Siraj mentioned the communities of practice learning theory. So this becomes very key in interprofessional modules. Learning is effective when learners can apply what they have learned in daily practice. So you should have an IP collaborative practice there so that what you teach, the student can apply. There should be a comfortable, blame-free environment. Only then the team will, flourish. And trained IP facilitators are essential for the program success. Now, it is important to inculcate IPE in the curriculum officially and not just another project, because only then the students will truly participate and the learning outcomes can be achieved. So, you know, assessment becomes important. So those are the few words that I had. And, I hope I was able to, provide some insights into IPE and especially IPE in dentistry.
Thank you, ma'am. After your session, I mean, like, we got a clear picture of the role of IPE in dentistry. Ma'am, I have a question. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Ma'am, you said dental and medical interactive modules for the undergraduates are important. I mean, like, it's for undergraduates as well as for postgraduates, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, ma'am, what do you suggest? How often do these interactive modules should we conduct, you know, for the effectiveness in IT anyway, if we want to incorporate it from in our students? So, the interactive modules, so how often should we conduct?
Now, that is not a very, you know, straightforward or easy question, because that depends on, first of all, what do you want to teach them? In terms of what is that education module that you want to, you know, put out there. And the second thing is, one of the main limitation is that already in the curriculum, you know, in general dental or even in medical or any other profession, for example, is already, you know, loaded. They need to take out free time to come up with this initiative. So really, you should, you know, take a step back and look at the entire curriculum and what are the aspects in which we can introduce IP. So in terms of how frequent, you know, it, so there are very few longitudinal programs. So a lot, you will see in literature, there are a lot of short-term programs. So if it is a module, like a two-day workshop or maybe a week-long program, you'll see a lot of that. But long-term follow-up is not many projects are there. And in terms of some of the evidence that is there out there, you know, long-term they have followed through the entire semester also, like the entire program of professional program of that individual. So there is no like one how often, but it depends on what your learning outcomes are and what is feasible as well. I don't know if that answers your question, but
yeah, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Definitely answered my question. Thank you.